Public Programs Coordinator at Penn America. I'm so glad that you've joined us this evening. This is the launch of our 2018 Penn Out Loud season. We really could not be launching it with a better pair of authors, so I'm going to keep this very brief so we can get Jason and Greg out on stage. As I mentioned, this event is part of a monthly conversation series called Penn Out Loud that we present in partnership with the Strand Bookstore, who are here tonight. Thank you so much for being here. Holding events at the Strand and here at Subculture all spring. You should have gotten a flyer when you walked in with a little bit of information. But just to summarize, in March we're celebrating A Wrinkle in Time, both the new film adaptation and the classic novel. We'll have Alice Sola Kim, Evie Zoboy, and Lana Roy and Charlotte Jonas Bloyquist, who are actually Madeleine L'Engle's granddaughters and biographers. They recently published a biographer of their grandmother. In April, we're doing two events. The first is with Sally Cohen and Rebecca Carroll, and the second is with Dr. Brittany Cooper and Darnell Moore. And finally, in May, Molly Crabapple will be here. She has co-written and illustrated a memoir of the Syrian War with Marwan Hisham, and we'll discuss that. Each event is an intimate author-to-author conversation, just like we'll have this evening, and we really hope that you will join us again. All of the details are on penn.org. There's a URL on those flyers where you can purchase tickets as well. Penn America's mission is to defend free expression and celebrate literature, and the Penn Out Loud series allows us to do just that, recognizing and uplifting voices and the literature that free expression makes possible. Penn is a membership organization, and if you're interested in learning more about our work or joining as a member, you can find out more on penn.org, or you can come and speak with a staff member, with me, or anyone wearing a Penn staff badge. I do want to thank The Strand again. They're selling books, I'm sure you've seen. After the event, please do buy a book. Jason and Greg will sign from the stage, so you can get a book and then come up on stage and chat with them. And now, without further ado, Jason Reynolds is a New York Times bestselling author, a National Book Award finalist, a Walter D. Myers Award winner, an NAACP Image Award winner, and the recipient of multiple Coretta Scott King honors. His critically acclaimed debut novel, When I Was the Greatest, was followed by The Boy in the Black Suit, All American Boys, co-written with Brendan Kiley, As Brave as You, and the first two books in the Track series, Ghost and Patina. His recent work includes Long Way Down and Miles Morales' Spider-Man. Gregory Pardlow's collection, Digest, won the 2015 Pulitzer Prize for Poetry. His other honors include fellowships from the Guggenheim Foundation, the National Endowment for the Arts, and the New York Foundation for the Arts. His first collection, Totem, was selected by Brenda Hillman for the APR Honickman Prize in 2007. He is poetry editor of Virginia Quarterly Review, and Air Traffic, a memoir and essays, is forthcoming April 10th and will be available at The Strand when it comes out. And I think we may actually hear from it this evening.
This. And also thanks to Mr. Pardo here for allowing me to share the stage with him. He does have a Pulitzer Prize. Yeah, I know. So I'm super grateful, man. I appreciate it. So I guess this will go, like, we'll keep it pretty loose.
Yeah.
We'll talk a bit, read a little bit, talk a little more, take some questions, maybe have a couple drinks.
So I had something I wanted to ask you about.
Yeah, man.
One of the things that I'm preoccupied with is my sense of obligation, my sense of responsibility as a writer. So I teach African American poetry at Rutgers in Camden, and one of the things that I'm always telling students is that African American literature in the early stages, well, not even in the early stages. I think around the turn of the 20th century, we got James Weldon Johnson and people like W.E.B. Du Bois were thinking really hard about what African American poetry should do, or African American literature in general should do. And there's this idea that it should serve not only to uplift the race, but also to uplift the image. It has some obligation to make Black folks look good. And in my, obviously in your work, you're thinking about what literature can do in terms of changing the world. I mean, I don't think that's an outrageous ambition. And I'm always thinking about what I am contributing to the world through my work. But I'm also resistant to the idea that I owe anybody anything, right? that I have any obligation to represent in any particular way.
I feel similarly in that I think that there's a conflation between this idea of writing something positive and making the race look good. And I think those two things get jumbled together, they get mashed up as if they're the same thing. And I find, at least for me in my own work, I think that some of those valuable things that we could do to change the world is be honest. That the beauty in literature, if we use it and if we wield it correctly, if we wield it effectively, I think that what it should do more than anything is recognize the fact that the Black community is not monolithic, right? That we are a polymath, that we are many, that we are mighty, that we are slivered and splintered, and it's just like
we are not in agreement
all the time. And we are not in agreement all the time, right? Like, I always tease young people when I'm talking to kids, I'm like, you do know that history will have you believe that every Black person in America was at the March on Washington.
Yeah.
And the truth is,
and supported it.
And the truth is, most of us weren't there. Or at the Edmund Pettus Bridge. My grandfather was anti-Dr. King.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he believed that Dr. King's beliefs were going to have his daughters murdered. He did not, he was like, we don't need that because we're safe in the silo, right? So we all have all these different ideas, and I think we have to recognize that. And the best that we could do with literature is to create honest narrative. And even if that honesty is only honest for a few people, at least they are represented, and therefore they will feel emboldened and empowered enough to be more fully themselves, which in the long run changes the world, right? Mm-hmm. You change yourself, change your family, change your block, change your neighborhood, right? Like, this is the way it works, but we can't do that if we're not sometimes validated by people outside of ourselves who say that I know that you think this way and everybody else thinks this way, and that doesn't make you other.
Yeah.
You're still okay, right?
One of the things that worry is too big a word, but as I'm reading your work, I'm thinking, this guy's really subversive. He's some stuff going on. He's challenging some ideas that are really like sacrosanct. And I'm wondering if people are picking up on it, but I know that there's a tendency to want to impose the safe narratives on what we're reading, right? And I know that, for example, I think when I'm reading, well, you work with Brandon. Where is Brandon?
Brandon, he's there. Is he here?
Brandon here?
He's probably not here. Okay. Right. Okay. Leave it to him in the Nash show. What a letdown that dude is. Just kidding. He knows
no,
how
to do that.
But yeah, Brandon and I, yeah.
Yeah, so that work is not, I think there's I worry that there's a tendency to read that book as All American Boys, as in service of African American literature.
Yeah.
Right? So, like, I mean, this is the common thing, like the Negro problem is the problem for Black folks. But that book was just so sort of liberating, just around even confronting ideas of who's down with who, right? And how we construct our sense of friendships, allegiances, and community.
But isn't that, but that's the thing, right? Like, there's this idea that if you're telling a Black story, quote unquote Black story, that it is void of all the people who make Black stories what they are. The only reason that my life is what it is one, because of sort of me, but also because of my cultural context and the environment around me that sort of sometimes presses down upon me to make me adjust to be a certain way, right? So like, I can't talk about racism and not talk about white people. Like, that's a reality, right? And so if we're writing a story like Brendan and I wrote about All American Boys, it's not a story about the victim of the brutality, right? It's the story about the people who get to escape brutality. And what exactly is their role when having these sorts of conversations? That has not, so like, we, it's interesting, right? And the assumption about that book is that it was my idea, right? So like, no matter where you go, if you were to ask any audience who's read that book, like, who do you think wanted to write it? People would be like, it was probably Jason, probably wanted to write the book. But the truth is that I hadn't even been thinking about writing something about police brutality because I don't ever see myself outside of my own body. I don't intellectualize what it means to be a black man in America because I just am that. So it was hard for me to distance myself enough to write the book. So it was Brendan who said, yo, you should probably try it. And he said, I've never seen to this day a novel that addresses, that has a white protagonist addressing whiteness and racism to this day. He was like, we need to figure this out. And I was like, all right, bro, if you sure. Like, but excuse me. So speaking about this idea of what is expected for us, this idea of even like who gets to write what, yada, yada, yada. So there's this poem, and it's actually at the end of the book. Y'all read this yet? Some of you. What you here for, right? This is why they didn't invite you to these kind of things. Well, you should pick it up after this. But there's this piece that I personally love that felt in its simplicity super, it was like knife twisty. It was like, you know, it's like a middle finger. In an interesting way though, I don't know if any of you have ever seen Sonia Sanchez read her work. If you haven't, you are missing out on an incredible experience. And she's getting older, so let's make it quick. honestly, right? When she starts her readings, every reading, she always begins with exactly. So she always, this roll call, right? And this roll call has expanded over the years. I mean, this thing is intense. And basically what happens is she stands on stage and she just recites. I mean, at this point, it's like hundreds of names of poets, mostly of poets, right? Poets and people that have inspired her or that she believes needs to be invoked, right? It's like, look, if I'm gonna enter into this space and I'm gonna invite you into this space, I'm also going to invoke the people that make me who I get to be. Mm-hmm. And there's this piece you've titled Cervantes. Everybody knows who Cervantes is. If you don't, it's okay. Cervantes is, if this is the Cervantes he's mentioning, is the Spanish writer who wrote Don Quixote, which is the most translated book and one of the most successful books on earth besides the Bible. Though I am so tempted to read it myself, and I really am because
I think that would be cool actually.
Yes.
The reason I'm scared to do it is because I don't want to ruin certain. These are people that you know, and these are people that I. Some of these people I know.
Well, you have full.
Okay.
All right,
here we go. We're doing it.
Go.
All right. This is called. This is at the end of the book. This is toward. I mean, there's maybe one or two poems left in this book. Yep. And at the end of the book, it reads Cervantes. If it answers no other purpose, this long catalog of authors will serve to give a surprising look of authority to your book.
That's a legit quote from Cervantes. Yeah, from like it was like an introduction or something to one of the to some edition of Quixote. Yeah. He's talking trash, right?
This is like a little finger, right? Like this. To explain, what does he say?
He's saying that we have, that authors have a tendency to invoke other authors as a way of bigging up themselves, right? Of saying, you know, I'm down with, and actually this is something I talk about, I kind of hint at throughout the book, like I'm down with Wallace Stevens, so, you know, I can invoke, you know.
I'm going to get a blurb from you.
I'm going to get a blurb, right. Right.
Well, this ancient blurb on
it. It's just interesting, right? This idea that we are, like, this is the list of vouchers, right? This interesting list of vouchers. Come on, man, just read
So, I'm not even going to read the whole thing, actually, because I think you'll get the idea. And it looks like this, right? This is the shape of the poem. Cervantes, if it answers no other purpose, this long catalog of authors will serve to give a surprising look of authority to your book. Vimy, Aaron, Camille, Ruth E., Scoob, Timothy, Holly, Matika, Tihimba, Hugh, Major, Sandra, TSE, Shay, Jennifer, Robbie, Joseph, Willie, Tracy, Tina, Ilya, Patricia, Jonathan, Kathy, Sue, Melissa, Rigoberto, Ada, Jen, Issa, Kazem, Natasha, you get the idea. So it just goes on listing this list of poets I know, my friends. And it's also kind of riffing on the idea, like in the back of our books, we have our acknowledgments, and oftentimes I look at these acknowledgments, and what we're doing, intentionally or not, is creating a community. You know, this is who I roll with. These are my peeps. And by making this list, one of the things I'm pushing back against, whether it's an actual thing out there or not, is the idea that my list of acknowledgments, my list of community, should be people who are writing just like me, or who look like me, or who are coming from the same background as me. These folks are all over the place because that's the kind of world I live in, the kind of world I appreciate. So I'm invoking, and they're legit, my friend. I know these folks.
It's humble brag. but let me ask you this. If the acknowledgement of all the people that you know in terms of poets, these are the poets that, you know, have inspired you in some way, shape, or form, and they're vast, right? They run the gamut. Can we talk a bit, because I've read this, and I've also read most of your memoir. Can we talk a bit how much you are influenced, if at all, your work by your family? And I speak specifically about your father. I think, and I asked permission to talk about this because, you know, it's tricky. I mean, family stuff is always a little slippery. But I specifically your father, a complex person, like most of us, someone who I found myself wanting desperately to love and being really frustrated by a lot of the times. Someone who I found myself directly connected to when it comes to some of the narcissism that I find in my own household. And furthermore, right? How much of him is a part of this work?
So I do two things. I'll read just the first paragraph or so of the book. And then I'll tell you a quick story that addresses what you're just saying.
And then I have a request.
Okay.
There's one part that is amazing.
Route 66. My father loved my father loved Hollywood and just media in general. And so he was always referencing some movie or something. And he also died at 66. By some concoction of sugar, prescription painkillers, rancor, and cocaine, my father, Gregory Pardlow Sr., began killing himself after my parents separated in 2007. He measured his health and lifestyle against his will to live and determined he had 10 years left in the tank. Though he did fuck up and live past 65, as he was afraid he might, he was only a year over budget. He lived his last years like a child with a handful of tokens at an arcade near closing time. Those tokens included access to credit, the patience and generosity of his family and friends, and any saleable assets, including, possibly, the titanium urn that contained his mother's ashes, mysteriously missing from the one-bedroom Las Vegas apartment where he chose to fizzle out. These resources had to be exhausted. He didn't want to endure penury, but neither would he ever leave money on the table, as he so often put it. So that's the introduction to my old man in the book. And he is a hero figure throughout the book. Who I want desperately to be a hero, and he keeps being human, and you know the frustrations with that. So his influence on my work. Today was the third day, I was telling you in backstage, the third day of recording the audiobook for Air Traffic. So I'm in the studio all day recording, and you know, it's work. I'm just pushing through, trudging through. There's a poem that he loved, Rudyard Kipling's If. I got issues with Rudyard Kipling. Everybody got issues with Rudyard Kipling, right? The man was messed up. They were too problematic. That aside, my father loved this poem, and he would recite this poem off the top of his head. I'm getting choked up. He would recite this poem off the top of his head, and he would throw lines at me when, in like moments of you know, when I needed wisdom or something, he would just bust out with, "If you can keep your head when all about are losing theirs." And so today we're at the section where I'm reading the poem, If. And I'm reading through, and I have the headphones on, and I can hear his voice in my voice, and it just wrecked me. And I had to admit, I mean, I was present to the fact that so much of my musical ear, so much of my sense of passion for the literature and for, yes, for the music and the language, absolutely comes from him. Yeah.
It's interesting in the book, there are these moments. So his father, the portrayal of his father, so he's like a genius. Like he's like this guy who's like his mind. Yeah, it was wild. Like he's like one of these, and this he reminds me a lot of some of my uncles. Like this guy who, it's easy to sleep on him until you challenge him, and then he gets busy on you, right? And it's like, and it was fascinating to read it. There's this one moment where a young Greg asks his father to. His father was an air traffic controller for a bit, and he asks his father to sort of explain what it's like to be an air traffic controller. Can I read this?
Okay? Yeah,
this is one moment. And I'm gonna read his father, and so his father would go on like these diatribes, basically like, I'm gonna give you all this work. I'm gonna tell you everything you need to know about everything. And there's a moment halfway through this sort of explanation where he says, "What makes it tricky," my father said, "is that some of your ideas, you can sense them, but they haven't really occurred to you. Yet you don't yet have words for them. These make up the rhythm of arrivals and departures that you know will occupy the major routes and routine intervals. They're just a feeling pricking your ears. Each idea is unique. Some are slow to reach you and sink like jellyfish, while others swoop in like flying squirrels, but they all fit into the same physical grammar. More than anything else, the one rule that matters is spacing. The one true element of the universe, emptiness, incremental negations, putting nothings between somethings, that's what makes order of the chaos." Right. And so as I'm reading this, and this is early in the book, and I've already read Digest, I've already read interviews, I'm thinking about my own life as a writer, and all I can think to myself is that a man that I've never met has explained through air traffic control what it means and what it feels like to work as a writer every single day. Mm-hmm. And a powerful moment for me, right? It's like, this is what it feels like. Every day, right? This thing pricking at your ears, the power in space, the power in the silence, the negative, right? All of these sort of things that's wrapped up. And I don't know if that's intentional or not. And I don't know if it matters, honestly. Because that's the power of storytelling, the power of humanity, right? And two, the power of your particular father in this particular moment that we all can sort of use, you know?
Tell me about your dad, your father.
Bring out the couch.
Yeah.
You know what? Honestly, my pops was a knucklehead when he was younger, and but a good guy, you know. But I had a lot of issues because my folks split when I was 10. And my father was always the coolest dude in the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. So my pops, when I was growing up in the 80s, in the early 90s, my father was covered in tattoos. And back then, it was just rare for black men to have tattoos, especially his age. My father was, you know, his mid-30s in the 1980s, and he was covered in tattoos. And that was just a rarity. And he had those tattoos since the 60s, right? Both of his arms covered in tattoos, right? He wore gold chains around his neck, and he wore like ripped t-shirts and like jeans, and like he looked like Lenny Kravitz looks today. Right? Like the way Lenny Kravitz dresses, my father was dressing like that in the 1980s. It was a cool dude. He drove fast cars and motorcycles and like the whole thing. He was the bad. My mom always says I married the bad boy, right? But besides all of that, besides the sort of outer appearance of this man, he was like the best father ever, right? So he would, my mom worked early in the morning, so my father was responsible for getting the kids up. He made us breakfast, took us to school, and we would blast the music and sing all kinds of whatever he was jamming to at the time, whether it was Bob Marley or Jimi Hendrix or Eric Clapton or the Stones, or he had a Hall & Oates phase, and we were jamming the Hall & Oates. He was the first person to ever play Nirvana for me.
Wow.
Right? My father played Nirvana for me, right? All this stuff.
Was he a musician?
He played like loosely, but yeah, I wouldn't call him a musician. Okay. But he was just that kind of person, and then he left. And it felt like it was crazy. He left, and he came back, and he left again. And I hated him for 15 years.
Mm-hmm.
And it was tough. You know, I just didn't understand how he could do that, how he could disappear. And I didn't want a relationship with him beyond sort of a high and by, or, you know. And when I was 25, I got to sit down with him, and we hashed it out.
Yeah.
And he told me the whole story, which is a very different story than the one I had made up in my head as a child, right? That our parents, our fathers, are human beings. He was my age. And I think about who I am. I mean, y'all here, y'all see what did it, right? I think about who I am, and I'm like, I can extend a bit of grace. But I noticed that in my books, for instance, a kid asked me once, he said, yo, I'm reading all the track books, and how come the fathers, like, either they're gone, or they're mean, this, that, and the third, is because after thinking this through with my therapist, I was like, oh, perhaps it's because my father left when I was in middle school. It's almost as if I can't put him in a story, so I can't write him in there because that's when he exited my life. I can't seem to make it up. It's like he wasn't there, and for some reason I can't suspend reality long enough to plop him in a story that he was not a part of. Even if it's always
Miles' dad is around.
But I didn't make Miles up. Somebody else made Miles up. I couldn't change that, right? Like, and Miles is in high school, right? But if Miles is in middle school, I don't know that my subconscious wouldn't have gotten in the way and sort of fooled with his father in a different way. In a different way, it's even in As Brave as You, the pops, they're going through divorce, right? And Ghost, the pops, tries to murder his son, and Bettina, the pops, is dead, and Sonny, the pops, is mean. Like, it's like a weird, and I'm trying, it's interesting. I mean, writing is such a fascinating human experience if you're paying attention. And I'm trying to sort of now work through some of that stuff. But I love an old man, he's great.
Mm-hmm.
He's great.
What's the role of the military and sort of patriotism and this stuff in the war?
Well, I think, it's funny, Brendan and I, he made it, by the way, he is here now. We shouted you out, bro, but you weren't here.
Hey, what's up, man?
you were late.
CP time.
Exactly, except that. It's funny, we were talking about this earlier today. So there's an All-American Boys, there's some military stuff, and there's Brave as You, there's some military stuff, and you see it in the work. And one of the reasons why is because I write primarily for young people. Young people, I mean, if you're 15, you've never lived without war.
Oh, shit.
Right? You have never known life without this country being at war. The other thing is, I like we both like to sort of fool around and figure out how we can really kind of unpack the fact that like war doesn't just mean war abroad, right? And that there are all kinds of wars that so many of us are fighting, and there are wars. I mean, we are war right. I mean, look, we're having in Florida. We are war right now, right? There's all kinds of battles being fought. Militarism is interesting too, because it ties into the police force, which we talk about a lot in our work. And also, it has a lot to do with the idea of what it means to be in line, and therefore the idea and the consequences of what it means to step out of line. I'm fascinated by that. And lastly, for me, my pops, man, this is where he bleeds back in. That whole side of my family, they were military men. My father, they were all military men. My father says the military saved his life because he wasn't doing anything with it. And his father was like, oh, son, you got like 2 weeks to make a choice, you know? And so he went to the army, traveled the world, and got his life together. And so I grew up in a household that said that there's nothing greater than for a black boy in America than for him to join the army. And so my father tried to force me into the ROTC when I was in college. And I fought him, and it was one of the ugliest moments of our lives, because I had to take agency over my own life at 17 years old and say, here's what I'm not going to do. And of course, this was the argument that we had. This was in August of 2001. I fought him. We had a big blow up, and it was ugly, and it was we called him all kind of names. It was a whole thing. And then a month later, the Twin Towers fall, and America goes to war. And that would have been me. Mm-hmm. And if I'd have gone to war, and if I would have died in a war, my family's not blaming George Bush. My family's blaming my father. And we've talked about that, and we've hashed all that out, and he's apologized, and I don't know, man. Father stuff, man, it's weird. Most people, it's daddy issues is for real. But like I say, man, I love the dude. We're good now, and at some point, I'm gonna honor him in one of these books. I'm gonna figure it out. But speaking of family, there's another poem, Problemata, that I love, and so good. And there's really one section that I really, really love, and that's the third section. We talk about your brother. You wanna read it?
Sure. I finally friended my brother. It may be we will never speak again. Why speak when we have this crystal ball through which to judge one another's lives? I imagine this is what the afterlife will be like. I'm ghost, we say, instead of goodbye.
So the brilliant thing, right? You all have to forgive me. I'm mad excited. I apologize. The brilliant thing about this poem is the first line says that I finally friended my brother, and it was so strange for me to have to reread this line, because I kept saying like, I think he meant to say he befriended his brother. Right? And then I was like, oh, it's 2018. Right? Like, you have this moment where you're like, he really means he like friended his brother on social media, right? And I was like, gosh, I befriended him. And I was like, man, this is some poetic license. I'm reading it over and over again, and I'm like, he friended. I'm like, finally, maybe it's alliteration. He's doing like a lot of work. It was crazy. And then I was just like, and then I read through it, and I'm like, oh, snap. There's these pop culture references, obviously, right? And this idea of like, and then of course the colloquialism about ghosts, which I thought was brilliant. Here's the thing, I don't want to give away so much of his story. One, because it's not my story to tell, and two, because I want you all to buy his memoir. I didn't know some things, and I don't want to give it away, about your brother and about...
Oh, yeah. No, we can do that.
We can do that?
Yeah, yeah.
Did y'all know? I had no idea. I was like, what?
No, that is
it's bugged out, man. Did y'all know that Greg's brother is one of the dudes from City High?
Some of y'all don't know.
So City High was like an R&B group with Claudette Ortiz and the dude from Sister Act, whose name I'm like, you know what I'm talking about? He's saying, oh, happy day when he was a little boy, and he grew up, and he still looked exactly the same. You know what I'm like? Yeah. So Greg's brother is the other dude in the group. Some, so when you leave it, Google City High, so you can see what's happening. This is like writing a poem live, right? That references that no one knows. But Greg's brother is the other dude from City High. Right? And so when I'm reading about your father, and I'm reading about all the father stuff, and then I get to your brother, and I'm reading about all the brother stuff. One, I guess my question is, like, you know, I know in my own work I use a lot of this stuff. I try not to, but it always comes in. But there feels like so much loss. It just, and I could be wrong, but it just feels like so much loss in terms of.
Yeah, I think that is one of the things that I'm wrestling with in air traffic, and the primal loss is the strike. I mean, so my family life, our home life is kind of defined. So that my father was an air traffic controller, and in 1981, they went on strike. And rather than negotiate with the union, President Reagan just fired 13,000 federal employees.
Thanks.
My father was one of them. And it was a really good job for men, mostly, who had not gone to college. And so we went from this kind of really Leave It to Beaver, you know, suburban. We literally had a picket fence. We had an in-ground swimming pool. To no pension, no health care. We had a cooler out back in the winter and the snow to keep our milk and cheese cold because there was no electricity. We had the kerosene heater. And so that, and my father was 27, something like that. And yeah, and again, I think about myself at 27. It's kind of scary. But that job was, you know, it defined him, it defined us as a family. And so that loss, how it devastated my dad, it just filtered into everything, our entire self-image. And so my brother's career tanking so spectacularly is a replaying of that. And I went through my own crisis, which I see after many conversations with my therapist as a repeat of that, right? So there is a sense of, not only a sense of loss in the past, but a sense of inevitable loss that I'm dealing with, right? I keep casting, pitching it out into the future. And so I'm trying to wrestle it into language, into some kind of concept that I can nail down and deal with. It's an absence. It's a negation.
Yeah. But there's also a presence. And when I think about the presence in this work, I also think about your children.
Yeah.
And there's this one poem I'm looking for, because I love it. And this is the one about Food Town.
Yeah.
Anybody live in Brooklyn, you know Food Town. Shout out to Bed-Stuy, shout out to Food. Shout out to Food Town. Shout out to Key Foods, no Key Foods, Food Town.
It's in the Problemas, the early
on. And it's just anybody who lives in Brooklyn, anyone who has watched the turning of Brooklyn, so to speak, the washing of this community, specifically Bedford-Stuyvesant, Crown Heights, Fort Greene, Brownsville, like these neighborhoods, Bushwick, right? I think this poem. It's Problema, let's see, not because Venus would be favorite three. Oh yeah, the Fulton Street Food Town, how it starts. Yeah, I'll let you do it.
So you know why they call it Problemas? I'm ripping off Kierkegaard.
That's why he's got the coolest
Kierkegaard is thinking about, he writes Fear and Trembling, and he's thinking about the Abraham and Isaac story. And so these poems are thinking about me as a father and the subtle forms of aggression and violence that get channeled through fatherhood, period. parenting in general. The Fulton Street Food Town is playing Motown, and I'm surprised at how quickly my daughter picks up the tune. And soon the two of us, plowing rows of goods steeped in fructose under light thick as corn oil, are singing, "Baby, I Need Your Lovin'," unconscious of the lyrics foreboding. My happy child riding high in the shopping cart as if she's cruising the polished aisles on a tractor laden with imperishable foodstuffs. Her cornball father enthusiastically prompting with spins and flourishes and the double barrel fingers of the gunslinger's pose. But we hear it as we round the rice and goya aisle. That other music, the familiar exchange of anger, the war drums of parent and child. The boy wants what? To be carried? To eat the snacks right from his mother's basket? What does it matter? He's making a scene. With no self-interest beyond the pleasure of replacing wonder with wonder, my daughter asks me to name the boy's offense. I offer to buy her ice cream. How can I admit recognizing the portrait of fear the mother's face performs? The inherited terror of nonconformity, frosted with the fear of being thought disrespected by or lacking the will to discipline one's child. The boy's cries rising like hosannas as the mother's purse falls from her shoulder. Her missed step from the ledge of one of her stilted heels, passion loosed with each displaced hairpin. His little jacket bunched at the collar where she has worked the marionette. Later, when I'm placing groceries on the conveyor belt and it is clear I have forgotten the ice cream, my daughter tries her hand at this new algorithm of love. Each word punctuated by her little fist. "Boy," she commands, "didn't I tell you?"
Yeah, so that's what I tell you. That's what I want to tell you, right? Here's a confession. So I read that poem. That's another one I read like 10 times. I was like, and the brilliance of it, the brilliance of poetry in general, when it's working for us, is I read the poem and I was like, that's a white lady and her child. You never say that. It's never in there, right? But my own sort of cultural context and the way I was raised, right, all the things, it's an interesting thing, right? Because for me it was like, in my mind, I'm like, my mother, nah, you know, that it's not happening, right? In my mind, right? The way that I'm synthesizing the world and seeing the world is like, nah, that ain't, it's not, my mom is all about, do not embarrass me in this store. Like, I grew up like that. Do not embarrass me in this store. It's gonna be hard times for you, right? We're not doing that. We're not doing that. No, talking between teeth, that whole, I grew up like that. And whenever I was with my mother and we'd be in stores and we'd see children wilding out, hitting their mothers and stuff, I'd be like, my mom be like, "You see that? You see what we won't have, right?" But the brilliance is that you never actually say that, which means that I could be wrong, right? And I know that you also, there's an essay, there's a part in this where you talk about stereotypes, where you talk about all performing blackness, where you talk about all these sort of really complex ideas that make our comfortable little spaces that we all reside in culturally a little less comfortable, that challenges us. Even having your daughter try her hand, right? And we don't see your reaction, right? We don't see you do what my mom would have done. The speaker may have done that or may not have done that, which is a brilliant move, right? I'm not gonna show you what the parental response is going to be because I know what you think it's going to be, right? And I just, kudos to you, man. I just think, for me at least, it was like, man, one, the stereotype and the prejudice that I have, I'm good with it. It's there, right? I still think that, you know what I'm saying? Just so we're clear. when I see it happen, I'm always just like, you got my mother, I'm always cool, my folks are always cool. You got this one solid, just give them a pluck in the ear, something. But I do like, and I think we all would be better off if we liked our comforts to be challenged. And so kudos to you. I would read something from my own book, but I don't have any books. I know the Strain has some copies. We have 5 minutes, and we only have 5 minutes left before we open it up for some questions. I know.
I know, man.
Anything else you have, Luke?
Yeah. Well, I wanted to ask you about theater, actually, because Long Way Down seems custom made for the stage. Mm. Was that? Did you have that in mind?
Nope. I've never done theater. I've been to a few plays though. You know, but even that came later in life. I didn't. Thank you. it will be on in theater. It's going to be at the Kennedy Center. They're doing an adaptation of it, and I can't wait to see what it looks like on the stage. But honestly, I wrote it in this sort of way because the honest answer is just because I wanted to experiment. I wanted to see what I could do. I wanted to see. I mean, I've been trying to figure out how to incorporate
with poetry.
I've been trying to figure out how to incorporate it back into my. I mean, most of my prose has all these the same elements that we use in poetry. I'm using my prose because that was the original discipline that I learned. That was my entree into writing in general. Like it was poetry was my way in, and so I like. And so because of that, I have there's a certain kind of irreverence that I approach the page with because I still believe that you can do whatever you want to do. Right? I honestly believe that you can wield language however you choose. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, it doesn't. But you can do whatever you want on the page. You can move things around. You can break lines in prose if you feel like it, right? And so I wanted to see, well, how can we tell a story that, in case you don't know what this is about, but how can we tell a story about somebody's life in a matter of like 60 seconds, right? Mm-hmm. This is 60 seconds of this kid's life told in 300 pages. Mm-hmm. How can we do that? I know what we can't do is do that in prose, right? Because I needed to figure out ways to break it down into these bite sizes so that it could move like seconds, it could tick like seconds. Mm-hmm. Each word, everything is sort of functional. How do we use scope? How do we use setting, right? I'm gonna put him on an elevator. Why put him on an elevator? Well, because he's experiencing trauma, and elevators are the physical manifestations of what a traumatized mind actually is, right? There's cold, it's cold, and it's small, and it's tight, and it's rickety, and there's vertigo involved, and it's hanging on by a thread, right? Like it's the physical manifestation, and how do we use poetry, how do we use verse to mimic the very same thing in shape, to mimic the very same thing in the words we use and the words we don't use? How do we create tension and urgency and pain and all these things that I think is at its core the magic of language. I'm super grateful for this. I think I took a risk and I'm glad I did. Even if the book failed, I still think that it's necessary for us as writers to push ourselves and to swing back, you know, like as hard as possible.
Could you, I don't know what you want to give away or not give away, but the section, there's a couple of poems where the dad puts the gun to his head. No, let's save that.
I like how you're like, okay, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna give the book away.
I don't wanna give the book away.
Let's give the whole thing away. It started with the father putting a gun to his child's head.
Just that section. Nothing more.
Mind you, I've done such a good job at not giving your books away. The minute mine gets up and you're like, hey, so he's gonna do this.
Alright, so y'all know, don't tell nobody what you heard here tonight.
Yeah. Alright, but now I'll find, let's see. I'll find something for sure. We'll from that part. let's see.
Well, there's also the section with the rules where he's introduced to the rules. That's heavy too.
All right. So let's do. In 2 seconds. So I'll read a part about the rules, and then I'll read a short little something about his father.
Awesome.
There's this one part that I really want to read about his dad, where he talks about him seeing kids in the park with their fathers. Yeah, here it is. All right.
Great. Yeah.
pop, stepped in the elevator, stood right in front of me, stared as if looking at his own reflection, as if he'd stepped into a time machine. Moments later, spread his arms, welcomed me into a lifetime's worth of squeeze. Is it possible for a hug to peel back skin of time, the toughened and raw bits, the irritated and irritating dry spots, the parts that bleed? Random thought number four. There's this thing I used to see kids at the playground do with their dads. They'd stand on their father's feet, the dads holding the kids by the arms, walking stiff-legged like zombies. The kids had to trust the fathers to guide them because the fathers could see what was coming, but the kids, holding tight to their dads, moved blindly backward. And that way we don't give too much of it.
Cool.
But I'll read a quick section about the rules and then we'll take some Q&A. You guys have been awesome. I hope you have enjoyed this as much as I have. I got mine. There's this part about the rules. Yeah. Here we go. The rules. Number one, crying. Don't. No matter what, don't. Number two, snitching. Don't. No matter what, don't. Number three, revenge. If someone you love gets killed, find the person who killed them and kill them. The invention of the rules ain't come from my brother, his friends, my dad, my uncle, the guys outside, the hustlers and shooters, and definitely not from me. Another thing about the rules, they weren't meant to be broken. They were meant for the broken to follow. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Say, can we turn the house lights up? House lights? Lisa Lucas!
Hey, Lisa, hey!
Thanks. So you guys were talking about, therapy, right? So in my family, and presumably within the Black community, right, that's not a thing two generations ago, right? That's not a widespread thing. So what do you think that means for literature, that you have a generation of writers right now who are sort of parsing the emotional experiences that they've had as children, as adults, as parents? What do you think that means for Black literature?
That it's going to get worse. Just joking. what I honestly think, for me at least, is one, I think it will encourage the longevity of our lives to continue to write certain stories. First of all, I think stress and our inability. The idea that we don't have space to express ourselves oftentimes either cuts our physical lives short or our literary lives short. The other thing is that what I'm hoping for, honestly, is that I have less fear in writing things far away from myself. And when I can deal with the things that I'm dealing with just me and my therapist, I don't necessarily always have to work them out on the page anymore. And now I'm freed up to write about Black people in space, right? Or like all the other things that I so desperately would love to talk about, but I've been minding my own issues and psychosis for so long.
I think the more inward the literature turns, the more diverse it becomes. Because I think certainly for me, and When I early on in my writing career, I would think of myself as, well, I'm a Black poet, so Black poets do this, or I'm a working class poet, so working class poets do this. And I was working in the superficial, I was working in the realm of categorical thinking. And the further I turn inward, and I think this is the case with so many of our friends, the more we turn inward, the more unalike the work becomes, right? So it's less, and it becomes more and more difficult to say, well, this is the state of African American literature, or these are the tropes of African American literature, or any literature, any quote unquote group identities literature, because just the act of looking at oneself as an individual and looking at the uniqueness of oneself, automatically you're working counter to the logic of categories. And so I think there's a, and I'm thinking in wish fulfillment terms, I think there's going to be a crisis of the what it means to be a Black writer. And I think the work is going to benefit immeasurably from that, because you know people will be looking to, as you said, to write about shit that you know that isn't expected or you know doesn't contribute to the secure notion of what we're one that's supposed to do.
Maybe that would no longer be a question of like mm-hmm. what does it mean to be a Black writer?
Yeah. Yeah,
we'll
yeah.
just all be doing our
mm-hmm.
thing.
Mm-hmm.
I love being a Black person, right? Mm-hmm. All the way. Right? But that's intriguing to think about without ever disowning the legacy of Black
yeah,
literature
yeah, yeah.
and what has
yeah.
come before us. But that is
yeah.
intriguing to think about what that means. Thanks, Lisa.
Thanks,
Dad. Anybody else?
Hi, Lincoln.
Hello. Coming from the other side of the table as an editor, like I'm always very conscientious beyond dotting the I's and crossing the T's, that I'm always maintaining my author's voice. How do the two of you dance with your editors to make sure that you get what you want on the page?
Yeah, that's a great question. Well, as a poet, I never had to work with an editor, right? In that way. And so writing prose now is a whole new relationship for me. And well, I guess the analogy that I have would be translating. When I translated poetry, the intimacy of the, you know, that mind meld that occurs when one is translating is probably the closest analogy I had. But as much as I just talked about, you know, not existing in the Black poet kind of realm, when I went looking for an editor, when we went shopping is a generous term, but for editors for this book, I really didn't expect anyone outside of my community to be able to hear my voice, right? And that was absolutely a failure of my imagination, because I adore my editor, and I think she hears me so well. And she hears me in ways that I can't hear myself, which is probably all the more important.
Same with me. I've been really fortunate with editors. My main editor, Simon Schuster, Kate Louie, who been working with me for quite a while, has edited a lot of books with me. You know what it is? I think I'm still a young writer, and now I understand why when we research all the writers that we love and our heroes, why they fought to stay with one editor. So many of them were like, look,
yeah.
this is a partnership and we riding this thing out.
Mm-hmm.
That makes so much sense
yeah.
to me now. It's like any other relationship. If you find one that sort of falls into play, out in the pocket and it's working and you understand each other and you trust each other and you can hear one another and you can see one another, there really isn't much else. I mean, it's incredible. I know for a fact, she's a middle-aged white woman. She who lives a very different life and has comes from a very different space, and yet has complete trust in my intuition. And when she doesn't understand something, she asks questions. She doesn't just strike it out, right? It's not like, this ain't it, right? It's like, look, let's have a conversation about what some of these codes mean that I don't necessarily understand. And once we have that discussion, that's it, right? Do you want to keep this? Yes, I want to keep this. Okay, well, I trust you, right? Are you, and then sometimes like, are you certain this should go? Yes, I'm certain this should go. And I trust her. I think that what happens is, as writers, we look at our work so sacredly, and I think that's a little arrogant.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, I think it's a little arrogant, right? I think at the end of the day, what no writer ever talks about is the fact that no writer writes alone. All of us have, all of us have collaborators that we are fortunate to have to make some of that work, to make all of that work come to life. And that is not beyond. Shout out to the good editors out there, the good ones. Any other questions? Don't come up to us after this.
I know, right?
Every time.
I had something I wanted to talk to you about.
Exactly.
I
Yeah, I certainly don't intend crisis in the pathological sense, and then you're absolutely right that that's the way we hear it, that's the way it traffics in the language. I'm thinking crisis in terms of a destabilization, crisis as a a disruption of the institution, just the stability of the idea.
She's like, listen, here's where I'm going to allow this. That's cool. I think at the end of the day, we do have to be cognizant of the words that we're using, right? Like, that's real. You know what I mean? So, I appreciate that for sure.
I want to hear about you guys' writing process. You know, when that first idea comes to the page, what does that look like for you?
Where do you start? Where do you start?
So, we were just joking in the room over there. You know, people are like, so what are you working on next? It's like, you know, I just wrote this book. So I'm in the moment of writing new stuff. And I'm interested in reinventing the wheel, right? And so I can tell you that my practice in the past had been to do a lot of reading in obscure stuff that is very far away from poetry, right? So a lot of philosophy, literary criticism, and just scrolling through the internet and finding whatever catches my eye. But now So my new project, I'm thinking a lot about stained glass, and so I've decided to learn how to make stained glass. I don't know how it's going to translate, but I think the key ingredient in my process is just to believe that it's going, and it will. It's an answer, right? So I'm just going to follow it and run with my interest in stained glass and see where it goes.
It's similar. I mean, I believe that the greatest gift that we have is our imaginations, but our imaginations only exist if we continue to fuel them by an insatiable curiosity. So you gotta, for me, it's like, I wanna know all the things there are to know, right? I just wanna know the things, and I think that is where I always begin, right? What am I curious about right this minute, right? So Brendan Tate knows I have this wild curiosity with birds. Like, I got this strange obsession with, like, understanding the way, because that's a whole other ecosystem that a lot of us don't understand. That's really fascinating. So I'm doing all this research on birds. I'm doing all this right now. I'm doing a lot of research on rain. I'm trying to understand, like, albinism and how it affects eyesight, right? How melanin affects eyesight or the lack thereof. I'm always reading a ton of anything, right? Whatever I like, you know, or whatever I don't like for that matter. At least Lucas says, give it 50 pages. So I mean, I give a lot of things 50 pages before you die close and keep it moving, you know what I mean? And sometimes you can glean a lot from 50 pages. You never know, even if it's just style. And then when I figured all of that out, when I've got all those things sort of bopping around up there, I try to figure out who I want to follow around. Who do I want to spend time with? I believe in the human story, right? I believe that that's what I write, slice of life, human, at least right now, right? Slice of life, human stories, which means that the human beings in the story have gotta be people that I wanna spend time with. And if I can write them in a way that feels like, if I can write them as humans and not as characters, this is what I always say, if you write characters, you're writing caricatures of humans.
That's great. Yeah.
Right, or you can write humans.
Right.
And if I'm writing a human being, then I would want to, and if it's somebody that I'm willing to spend some time with, the way that we do in real life, right? Human beings in our real lives that we love, nothing has to actually happen for us to have a good time with them, right? It's them that we love, mm-hmm. right? And if I can make that character, everything else sort of falls into place, right? And I know for a fact that we can spend 300 pages with this person, whether an explosion happens or not.
That's good. That's good. I think we're getting out of time.
There's only one more question.
Okay.
Could you speak to how you write?
writer.
And the editor, how that process works, so that you get a book that really is...
It's cohesive.
That's a great question.
So with this, Brenda was my second time doing this. Honestly, I think number one, it's like any other, you know, it's like a marriage, right? Like any other marriage, right? Where it's like, we talk about, he loves this because he loves to talk about us as married.
Because I love you, man.
I don't know how his wife feels. His wife is probably like, oh, the romance is way too much at this point. And so, with any situation, with any marriage, with any relationship, I think at first and foremost, the basis of it, there needs to be trust. Like, and that trust has to be earned, right? And it's no different with us. I trust them. I trust whoever, I trust my editor, I trust whoever I'm writing with, and I trust them, like, all the way. Like, I'm all, I told my editor, look, I walked through the fire with you, let's go. Like, if this, I trust, you've proven to me that you know what you're doing. Just like if you were my brother or my mother, right? Like, you've proven to me that in this particular context, you know, and you got my best interest at heart, let's roll. And so when we sat down around All-American Boys, we had already been talking about the issue, the conversation in the book for so long that when it came down to writing it, first of all, we were in separate countries, right? He was living in Italy, and we wrote most of the book blindly and swapped pages, swapped chapter, we're talking like 4 or 5 chapters at a time. And because of our relationship, it all sort of lines up intuitively. It's no different than you knowing what somebody wants to order before they order it, you knowing what people like to eat. It really works that way. And then the editor, her job was to basically smooth out the rough edges. She had already seen that what we made was what it already was. And she was like, right now, my job is to go through and finesse it to make sure that it feels like a cohesive piece. But all the points that I had matched up simply based on the fact that I trust the person that I'm working with. Thank y'all very, very much.
Grab a drink and hang out and come and get your book signed on stage. Thank you so much.